Hello friends, a very good evening. My name is Dhananjay Reddy and today we are continuing with our lecture on theories of international politics. So before going into today's theory, I just want to give a small review of what are the theories that we discussed so far in international politics. We are discussing Union Public Service Commission, Political Science and International Relations, Paper 2, Section A. That is the theories of international politics. This is a free lecture in which we are going to try to cover 80% of PSIR in the next 30 days. So this is our target. So as a part of that, we have started this initiative, and this is totally a free initiative for PSIR students. So we have started with the schools of international politics. The reason for starting this this topic is, in order to understand paper two, we should know what are the schools or what are the theories available in international politics through which we can study the respective other topics. Say, for example, if it is globalization, if it is global concerns like terrorism or multinational companies, these all can be understood in a very, very clear way only when we understand the theories or the schools of international politics. So this is the route from which the different plans or the plan is going to emerge. What is that plan? Paper 2 of PSIR is going to emerge. So we started with the theories of international politics. So that is our strategy on which we focused on so far. So today we are going to start with the next theory of international politics, and that is the Marxist theory of international politics. Now, so far we have discussed the realist theory and its subcomponents, and we have also seen the liberal theory and its subcomponents. So this is the third school in international politics that is known as the Marxist theory of international politics. So first thing first, as usual, let us see the names of the slides that are present, the photos that are present on the first slide. This is Mr. Karl Marx, the propounder or the root for Marxism. He was the main man who has propounded the theory of Marxism in international relations, not in international relations per se, but the ideology of Marxism has been given by Karl Marx. So that is why we can consider as father of Marxism. So as a tribute to him, we are keeping it here. But in international politics, the major role of Marxism was played by this man called Mr. Lenin. And this is the book written by Mr. Lenin, Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism. Is a book written by Lenin in which he explains the international politics. And then this is Hollander. As such, he is not important in international politics, but he has written a book called Frederick Engels and Marxian Theory on Political Economic Approach of International Politics. So we just keep these things in mind. So as far as today's discussion is concerned, he will be the prime focus because he is the man who he is the first man who propounded the theory of Marxism in international politics. Karl Marx, though he has given the ideology of Karl Marx, Marxism, he didn't describe about international politics. Whatever he has focused on the state level approach, up to the domestic politics of the state, but not at the international level. The only concept which Marx has given at the international level is the proletariat internationalism, that you might be knowing, right? He called for the workers across the countries to unite, and he gave a famous slogan called unite, workers of the world unite, you have nothing to lose but the chains. Right, that was the only contribution of Karl Marx in international politics. The rest of the contribution has been started by this great man called Mr. Lenin with his book called Imperialism, the Highest State of Capitalism. So this is about first theory, first slide. So let us look at Marx's theory of international politics. As I said, this is the third sub-school or third school in international politics. We have seen the realist school of international politics. We have seen the liberal school of international politics. And today, this is the third school that is called the Marxist School of International Politics. And what is the source for this Marxist theory? It draws its source or sustenance from the ideas of Karl Marx. Whatever the ideas that Karl Marx said, it has drawn its inspiration from the ideas of Mr. Karl Marx. However, Marx himself has not given any theory on international politics. Marx confined himself to the domestic sphere, as I just said now. He talks about proletariat internationalism. At the international level, Marx talks about only one thing, that is called proletariat internationalism, that is workers across the globe has to unite and they have nothing to lose but their chains. So it is the call that he has given for the workers across the countries, across the globe. So that is the only international perspective that Karl Marx has given. Apart from that, the entire contributions are the contributions have been started from Mr. Lenin. That is what I said. Though the ideas of Karl Marx has played a crucial role in the emergence of this theory. Let us look the sources. The first person who has developed the theory of international politics from Marxist perspective is Mr. Lenin. In his book, Imperialism, the Highest State of Capitalism. So in this book, he started analyzing the impact of capitalism between the states. Through this book called Imperialism, the Highest State of Capitalism, Lenin wanted to draw a relation between capitalism and how it is creating wars. Right? This is the second slide. The source is, so the first person, the theory of international politics from Marxian perspective has been developed only from the times of Lenin through his book, Imperialism, the Highest State of Capitalism. Now, what is the focus of Lenin? Lenin focused in his book on understanding imperialism. And he establishes a relation like imperialism is the highest stage of capitalism. Now, there exists a relation between imperialism and colonialism. Imperialism and colonialism. What is colonialism? Going and occupying the colonies for the sake of market, for the sake of raw materials is called colonialism. But what is imperialism? Extending the political powers on the colonies is called imperialism. Or I can say imperialism is the highest state of exploitation of the colonies. Slowly they colonize for raw materials, they colonize for the markets, but once as it reaches to the highest level, then they go for imperialism, that is extending the political power on the colonies. Politically they control the colonies, thereby making the puppet, making the governments of the colonies as puppets. So that we can see clearly in India and Africa. So in his book, he establishes a relationship between imperialism and capitalism. I said, what is the difference between imperialism and colonialism? Now, when we talk about imperialism, we are talking about the countries such as Asia, Africa, Latin America. Who were the colonies of Western world? That is UK, France, Netherlands. These were the first colonial masters in the globe. Later, USA joined to this race of colonialism, and the latecomers were USA, Germany, and Italy. They were also the expanding powers or the colonial powers who tried to have colonies. Who are those colonies? The colonies are countries of Asia, Africa, and Latin America. So Western countries here means the capitalist countries. This is just some basics that I was telling. So imperialism, Lenin focused on understanding the concept of imperialism. And he wants to build a relation between imperialism and capitalism through his analysis. So Lenin has established a link between colonialism with capitalism. According to Lenin, what Lenin says is, the cause of First World War is not because of anarchy or security dilemma, but it is because of the colonies, or it is because of capitalists who are trying to compete for colonies. Now let us discuss what we discussed in realism. Realist said that there exists anarchy, and anarchy is a reason for cause of war, because anarchy is going to result in security dilemma, and that is the reason which is making contribution to the war. But Lenin says that this is not anarchy, this is not security dilemma, but this is the war among the capitalist countries, the so-called Western countries, who are trying to compete among themselves for the sake of colonies. So Lenin's perspective of wars is not based on that of realism and liberalism. Realists and liberals believed anarchy is the cause of war, but Marxism believed that the cause of war is among the capitalist countries. Capitalism is the cause of war. Now I said, in theories of international politics, or the schools of international politics were established just to understand what are the causes of war and how to avoid war and how to bring an eternal peace in the globe. Right?
In their analysis of reasons or causes of war, they differ. Liberals come out with one theory, realists come out with one theory. But Marxists came out with the theory of capitalism. Capitalism is the cause for wars at the international level and not the anarchy which was propounded by realists as well as liberals. Liberals also said that anarchy is the cause of war. So it is war for colonies. First World War is war of colonies, war for colonies, sorry. From this theory, Lenin wants to say that the real cause behind the war was capitalism. So these fellows, they are confusing us. Realists and liberals are confusing us by saying that the war is because of the anarchy. No, this is war. This is due to capitalism. It is the difference between other schools and the Marxist school. And so what they offer? So if you want peace, how can you establish peace? By ending capitalism, because capitalism is the root for war. So by ending capitalism, you can end war. Thereby, you can establish the so-called peace. Right? That is the thing that I said, you know, schools of internationalism or international politics is about establishing peace. Marxism gives this idea. End capitalism and then you are going to have a peaceful world, right? This is what Lenin proposed. Now let us quickly compare the Marxist school with the other schools that we have read so far, the realist and the liberal schools. Now, why war takes place is an eternal question in international politics. Yes, international politics and international schools has emerged only because of this, to study why wars cause. So the eternal question is why wars take place in international politics. And really said that it takes place because of anarchy. Because of anarchy, there is security dilemma. And because of security dilemma, wars takes place. As a result, what are the suggestions of realists? They suggested the states to have deterrence. That is, you built the deter the aggressor through balance of power or through nuclear power. You either go for balance of power or go for nuclear power or you may go for diplomacy. But however, these are the tools that are available to ensure the national security. This is the solution which was given by realists. And what is the difference between balance of power as well as nuclear power? See, balance of power is a term which you use in conventional wars. But nuclear war is called as balance of terror. Or we also call it as mutually assured destruction. So these are the terms that we should know the difference. Okay, balance of power is a conventional war, right? This is just to give a clarity. So really said that the real cause is anarchy, and because of anarchy there exists security dilemma. So what is the solution they offer? The solution that they offer is you build the deterrence, deter the aggressor, whoever is trying to aggress, by building your balance of power or through nuclear power, or you may go for diplomacy. Whereas liberals also agree that what is the cause of war? Liberals agree that anarchy is the cause of war. And what is the solution that they offered? Rather than going for these type of things called balance of power, go for building international organizations, you strengthen the international regimes, you strengthen the laws, promote democracy and promote economic interdependence. So realists, the cause for realists and liberals of war is same, that is anarchy, but the solutions that they offer is different. Realists offered the solution of going for balance of power or nuclear wars or nuclear powers, but liberals said that source is same like realists, but they have offered don't go for balance of power, rather go for building institutions, building economic interdependence or building democratic procedures. This we have read. Now what Marx says, Marxism said that wars takes place because of capitalism, not because of anarchy. So the solution, what is the solution? You end capitalism. So this is the difference between the realists, the liberals and the Marxists. I hope you got the difference between these three schools that we have. This is the school that we are discussing. These two schools we discussed in detail. For Marxists, the source is capitalism is the source for war, and so the solution is end of capitalism, right? Now, the question is why capitalism is responsible for wars? How these persons prove that capitalism is responsible for wars? They say that capitalism is responsible for wars, but how capitalism is propelling wars across the countries? They say that capitalism by nature is an expansionist policy. Capitalism by its inheritance or by its nature has this thing called expansionist tendency. We'll see how that is expansionist. Nature is expansion, nature of capitalism. It is expansionist nature. Why it is expansionist? Because capitalism works for profit. So in order to increase profits, you should have cheap raw materials, you should have cheap labor, you should have bigger markets. So the capitalism means it works for profit. In order to have profit, you should have cheap raw materials, you should have cheap labor, you should have big markets. So this is why these capitalists come and occupy the colonies. And what are the colonies exactly? What exactly are the colonies? Colonies are the sources of cheap raw materials, cheap labor, and cheap and bigger markets. So the sources are, they are sources of cheap labor, cheap raw materials, and the places of selling finished goods at costlier rate. That is why Mr. Dadabhai Nauroji, he said that this results in drain of wealth. Right? I hope you heard this statement of Dadabhai Nauroji's drain of wealth. So this is a capitalists have expansionist tendencies and colonies are working perfectly well for them, for that expansion. So Lenin gives his perspective saying that once capitalism starts expanding or progressing, the competition becomes tougher and tougher. All the colony capitalist countries such as France, Germany, Italy, Britain, US, all these countries try to increase their presence in colonies. As it expands, capitalism expands, then there becomes competition among these colonies. As the competition increases, at one point of stage, it reaches the highest stage of competition. This highest state of competition of capitalism is known as imperialism as per Lenin. Right? I hope you are getting the point. So they are proving it. How capitalism is responsible for war? They say that capitalism has a tendency of expansionism because capitalism works for profit, and profit can be ensured only when there are cheap raw materials, cheap labor, and bigger markets, and colonies perfectly match these three requirements. And as a result, these capitalist countries, they increase the competition for these colonies among themselves. When the competition is increasing, it reaches at one highest stage, and that highest stage of capitalism is called imperialism as per Lenin. And we see, once capitalism reaches at highest stage, what is the nature? Features of capitalism at the highest stage. The moment capitalism reaches to the highest state, it becomes monopoly. Monopoly means one country will be having the entire power on the colonies. Like Britain exists, Britain's power, monopolistic power in India, right? And Africa. So once capitalism becomes the highest stage, what is this highest stage? The competition among the countries at highest stage. And the moment they are becoming monopolistic, they're going to expand. Monopoly is the means for exploitation. That you can see, monopoly of Reliance, monopoly of Airtel. The moment there exists monopoly, automatically they are going to exploit. This is the first feature of capitalism at the highest state or highest stage, right? This is the first feature of capitalism at the highest stage. Now, the moment it becomes highest stage, there is second feature, that is, it is going to finance capitalism. It becomes financial capitalism. What is this financial capitalism? It means it starts exporting capital. Rather, similar to the exporting of goods and services, finished goods and services, they export capital. money they export. For example, if you look at China, China has become an exporting manufacturing hub. So it is has monopoly in manufacturing today. As a result, it is expanding or financing in Africa and other countries. So this is the highest stage of capitalism. So capitalism, when it reaches to its highest state, it has two tendencies. One is monopolistic tendency, which increases the power to exploit. And the second thing is the it exports capital, which is called financial capitalism. For example, China is doing the same thing. Now, this is what at the highest state. But what about when new countries try to become capitalist? I said in the slide that initially there were some capitalist countries like the Great Britain. Then there used to be certain countries like France, Italy. So Germany was a new entrant. The moment Germany entered into capitalism, then there exist a fight among themselves, because for colonies, when new countries become capitalists, there also capitalism matures. That is, say for example, if a new country like Germany is trying to become capitalist, it tries to mature in that domestic politics. In Germany, it reaches maturity. The moment it reaches maturity, say for example, Germany and Italy at the Second World War, they challenge the monopoly. Monopoly which was established up to one point of time, they start challenging. Why? For the three requirements: cheap labor, cheap raw materials, and bigger markets. So already, if you want to eliminate or if you want to give competition to the monopoly, then automatically there becomes competition, and this increases the competition. The moment it tries to increase the competition, then the relations get strained. For example, once the relations between USA and Japan were really strained during the time of World War II. Why? Japan started expanding its colonial, expanding its powers, or expanding for colonies. It started going after colonies. Why? For markets, for cheap raw materials, for cheap labor. So this made USA and Japan to enter into the conflict directly in Second World War. Ultimately, it may result into wars that we have seen, right? Due to competition of markets. Now, how the war starts? It may start slowly with tariff wars or protectionist wars. That is that we are seeing between the Trump administration and the Chinese administration. And slowly, this enters into real wars. So it starts somewhere with tariff wars or protectionist tendencies, and as it progresses, it reaches into real wars. The moment there is war, then there will be more recruitment for army, then there will be national sentiment which will be generated among the public, and ultra-nationalism among the public leads to wars. So this is the explanation of Marx's saying that capitalism is responsible for wars of the global level, unlike the anarchy which was propounded by the realists and liberals. So if you want to eliminate war, you have to eliminate capitalism. That is the statement. How capitalism is being a source of exploitation, or how capitalism has been a source of war. That is, I said, capitalist, it has a natural tendency of capitalism is for more expansionism for profits. The moment they look for profits, automatically competition is going to get developed for the colonies. So this is results in war. So I said how Marx is different from other schools. Now, what are the salient features of Marxist school? If you look at the salient features of the Marxism school of international politics, the Marxist school of international politics draws its inspiration. The Marxist school of international politics draws its inspiration based on the sustenance of Marx theory. The first principle is it draws its principle from historical materialism of Karl Marx. So one is historical materialism. What is this historical materialism? The fundamental features of historical materialism are, it suggests that economic structure is the basic structure and politics is the superstructure. Karl Marx said, economics is the basic structure and the rest are superstructure, whether this is politics or this is any other thing, society or anything, they will be economics is the base. So this is said in historical materialism. They look at history through material aspect. Material means economic perspective of history, or material perspective of history is called historical materialism. So they say that the economic structure is the basic structure, Marx said, and then for them politics is epiphenomenal. Economics is phenomenal, politics is epiphenomenal, which means it follows, politics follows economics. So economics is the source, that is the phenomena, whereas epiphenomena is politics, which means politics is a derivative of economics. So if there is power struggle among the states, then it is actually economic struggle, because power is politics, politics means economics. So it draws its sustenance from historical materialism of Karl Marx, right? This is the first feature. Historical materialism means material evaluation of the history, right? I think you are getting the point. So they say politics is a derivative of economics. So if there is war or power for struggle, then definitely it is due to economic struggle and not any other thing. Right? This is the first feature. And then since Marx gives the economic reason behind what is happening in international politics, Marxism of theory in international politics is known as economic determinism. They say that economic determinism, we call it as economic determinism of international politics. Marx's school of international politics is also known as economic determination of international politics. It is a monocausal theory. There is only one cause. The cause is economics. There is no other cause. Only one cause, that is economics. So this theory is also known as monocausal theory. And as a passing remark, let us remember that Morgenthau's theory is also monocausal, because Morgenthau said that the cause for war is power. If they are giving only one cause for war, and then we call that as the monocausal theories. So Marx's school of international politics is also known as economic determinism of international politics, and it is a monocausal theory. And these are the salient features of the first salient feature that we are discussing, that is historical materialism. The second is the concept of class. What is this concept of class? Marx believes that state is an institution of the dominant class. State is institution of dominant class. It means if we are studying international politics, the real unit of analysis has to be class and not state, right? Whenever we are studying any school, or whenever we are seeing the global order or the global system, I said in any system there will be units or elements. Marx, realists and liberals said that the elements or the real units of the system are the states. But this is as per realists and liberals. But Marxists say that the real unit is not state, but class. Because states are the institutions of dominant class. So if you want to study the classes, not states. That is what Marxists say. Thus, these states, that is capitalist states, go for protection of interests of capitalist class. So in order to just protect the interests of the capitalists, these states go for war. So this is what Karl Marx says, or this is what the concept of class is. The first concept is historical materialism. The second concept is concept of class. Right? Now, for example, let us see the example how concept of class is evolved. Concept of class. Right, we are looking at concept of class. US policies towards Iran. Initially, Iran and USA were very, very good friends. Very, very good friends. Because in Iran, there used to be a puppetry regime. But after the change in the Iranian regime, that is the puppetry regime, then they nationalized the oil companies. Iranian government, they removed the puppetry regime. Iranian people revolted after the civil war. They established a democratic regime, or a regime which was established by the people, and they nationalized the oil companies. And as per the policy of nationalization, they have given the oil exploration rights, extracting rights to only Iranian companies, and they ousted out the Western MNCs from Iran. As a result, they created a war between USA and Iran. This is just because of Iran's nationalization of its oil companies and throwing out the MNCs of Western world. So this is described, in general, we describe it as a clash of civilizations. The academicians of the West describe this as clash of civilizations, but Marxists say this is not clash of civilizations. This is just a clash of economic interest. The economic interest of Iran and the economic interest of USA is what is the real reason for the ties getting deteriorated between USA and Iran. So don't confuse this with class of civilizations. You are giving a wrong term. Academicians Karl Marx or Lenin are telling you are giving wrong terms to this. They are a class of economic interests, not because of the civilizational clash. And there is one scholar called Noam Chomsky said US will go for war to protect the interests of capitalist class. US will not spare if their capitalist class was exploited or they were thrown away. US will be ready even to wage wars for the sake of their capitalist class. So what is Marx is saying? Marx is saying that it is not the state that has to be the real units, it has to be the class, because states are the representatives of the dominant class. So the real unit of analysis in international politics is class, and it should be class, unlike the realists and liberals who said that states are the basic units in international relations. Next, this is the third concept of salient features. That is, we read up to historical materialism. The second class is, this is first, the second thing is the concept of class. And now they apply this concept of class in the context of states. How they apply? They say Marxists applied the concept of class even in the context of states. They didn't say only in domestic politics there is class. Say, for example, in India, class is nothing but caste, right? They say that in India, there are existing different castes. They apply the same principle of class to international politics, to the states also. And how they give? They divide the entire states in the globe into two categories. Just like in India, we categorize the caste. The Marxists has divided the states in the globe into two classes. One is the core states, the other one is the peripheral states. So in Marxist literature, we will be coming across these two terms, and whenever we are writing an answer from Marxist perspective, we have to use these terms. That is the intention, what I am telling you, why I am telling you this. The core states and the peripheral states. What do you mean by core states? The core states are the term that we use, or the Marxists use, to represent the developed states or the Western states. And why they are called core states? Because they are core because they have the ultimate power. Concentration of power is with these states. What is this power? This is economic power, this is political power, and this is the power of technology or cultural power also. They have the concentration of power. Core states has concentration of power. As a result, they are called core states. Concentration of power exists. All sorts of power. The peripheral states are the least developed states, least developed countries or developing countries, or the colonial states. And they lack power. They do not have economic power. They do not have the political power. They do not have technological power. Neither do they have the power of culture. So they divided the states into two categories. One is the core states and the other one is peripheral states. Whenever you are writing an answer, go with these terms. They also gave the terms like northern states and the southern states. In international politics, if you are reading about northern countries and southern countries, northern states or southern states, such as the global north, the global south, these are the terms which was given by these persons who Marxists. So global north and global south are the terms which these persons have given, right? And the division of the states into north and south is a contribution of Marxists. The first worlds represents the core countries or the global north countries or the developed countries or the western world, which are representing prosperity, whereas the third world, which are known as the peripheral countries or the global south countries or the least developed countries or developing countries or the eastern countries or the global southern countries, they represent poverty. They are symbols of poverty, whereas the poor countries are symbols of prosperity. So they divide the states in this way. States are divided into two classes. One is the haves and the have-nots, right? They apply the same principle of haves and have-nots to the states also. So there exists a continuous struggle between the north and the south. The northern countries form cartels and they exploit the southern countries. So this is what the concept of states as per Marxists is. Now, the eternal wars of USA in Korea, in Vietnam, in the Middle East, in Afghanistan. If you look at the wars that USA has waged in South Korea, the wars that it has waged in, sorry, not South Korea, that was United Korea at that point of time. The eternal wars that USA has waged on South Korea, on Vietnam, on the Middle East, on the Afghanistan, these are the wars because they want to exploit, are the tensions that is prevailing between USA with the Iran, USA with Syria, are all the conflicts of core countries and the peripheral countries. Core countries are exploiting the peripheral countries in order to exploit. This war is the means, or the tensions prevailing. Examples are the tensions prevailing in Iran, the tensions prevailing in Syria, between Syria, USA's tensions with these countries, or USA's war that it has waged. They are all between the core and peripheral countries. So they say that this is, states are into divided into classes. What are those two classes? The core class and the peripheral class. Core class is also known as haves, and these are have not countries, have nots. They are very poor countries. They represent prosperity. They represent poverty. Right? So this is the classification, or this is the division which Marxists has given. Now Marxists make a difference between the two countries, like core countries and the peripherals that I said, unlike realists. What realists said? Now look at the third difference between realism and Marxism. Realists said that all states are similar. There is no difference between the states. All states are similar, and hence they cannot be differentiated. Liberals also said that all states are similar. For liberals and for realists, all states are similar. There is no differentiation between the states. All states are similar. Right? But for Marxists, states can be differentiated. How they are differentiated? They can be differentiated based on core and periphery. Core are haves and have nots. So that I discussed so far, right? This is what the difference of Marxism and other schools so far. I think you are getting the point. Now, so the aim of the realists is to prevent war, that we have seen through this. Liberals aim to prevent war along with promotion of prosperity. So they want economic interdependence. So this is what they suggest. Marxists aim at peace. So Marxists aim at peace. So all schools aim is only one thing, that is peace. Marxists also aim at peace, but how you can bring peace? Not by this means, not by this means, but by bringing justice and not prosperity. Because if you look at the term of prosperity, then these countries are saying prosperity of only few countries, that is the capitalist countries. So don't call this as prosperity, call it as justice. Justice means fair treatment of all states, fair treatment of all states. If you are saying prosperity, then it is only for few states. Fair treatment of all states is called justice. So they call for justice. Marxists call for justice and not prosperity. Prosperity was a term which was used by liberals for international politics. So they say this, right? I think you are getting the point. One second. So I think you are getting the point that I am discussing. We have seen three different the difference between the capitalism. So far we have discussed the difference between the three schools, that is Marxist, capitalist, realist, and the liberals. Marxist point is you have to have one thing called what you have, you eliminate, you focus for peace, not prosperity, because peace is the bigger term compared to prosperity. Prosperity means just you are speaking for few countries. So it speaks for the total countries. Give me 1 minute. I think there is some issue here. Right. So I think you are getting the point, right? What we are discussing, it is very clear, I hope so. So these are the salient features that we are discussing. Marxists say you go for peace because not just peace is justice. So Marxists speak about justice. Justice is fair treatment of all states. It is not just prosperity, which means just prosperity of few states. Okay, this is the difference. And what is the focus of Marxist theory of international politics? So what is the special focus? What they focus on the international politics? That is the focus of Marxist theory of international politics is they focus to give critical analysis of the operation of capitalism at the international level. Because they said capitalism is responsible for war. So their focus on international politics is a critical analysis of how capitalism is operating at the international level. So their entire study is on the capitalism, operation of capitalism at the international level. So Marxists study the operation of capitalism at the international level. And what is this called? Operation of capitalism at the international level is called as globalization. If you look at the meaning of globalization, this is the operation of capitalism at the international level. So capitalism operating at the international level is called globalization. If you see the nature and characteristics of the present trends of globalism, globalization is expanding or expansion of capitalism. If you look at if you have a general look at the capitalism or globalization phenomena in the world, then we look at expansion of capitalism. That is what we understand by globalization. So globalization is nothing but the capitalism at the international level, operation of capitalism at the international level. So they say that globalization is the highest stage of capitalism. So they study, Marxists study globalization phenomena at the international level. So this is what the concept is. So whenever we are studying globalization also, if you look at Marxist perspective, then globalization is responsible for war at the international political level, right? Now, when capitalism extends to, now they said that capitalism is expanding to globalization. But why, when did it happen? When did it begin? Capitalism, when did it begin to expand to globalization? Now, Marxists say it has begun only after the end of the Cold War. Globalization became the phenomenon, capitalism expanding to the global level only after the end of Cold War. Why only after the Cold War? Because after the end of the Cold War, every country started accepting the Washington Consensus and they moved towards the capitalistic nature of development. But before globalization or before Cold War, the end of Cold War, how the international system was? Till the end of the Cold War, capitalism was just limited to the Western world or the first world, right? If you look at Eastern Europe, or if you look at USA or North America, then definitely these countries were just capitalists. What about the Eastern Europe, Western Europe, West European countries? Sorry, Eastern European countries. This is West Europe, this is Eastern Europe. Russia, Japan, China. What about these countries? They are not capitalists before end of Cold War. They are communist blocs. And what about Latin American countries? What about South African countries? What about India? What about these countries? They are non-alignment blocs. They are called non-alignment blocs. They are socialist blocs. So until the end of the Cold War, the global situation was divided into three phenomena, that is the capitalistic school, the socialistic school, and the communist school. But after the Cold War, end of the Cold War, then capitalism started becoming a global phenomena. Why it has become a global phenomena? Because every country started accepting the Washington consensus and the capitalist way of development. Because they have seen that if you go through the communist mode of development, then just like USSR disintegration, the countries are going to get disintegrated. So that was a concept, and they said that Washington consensus is the better way for the development of the nations. So it is only after the end of the Cold War that globalization really showing its impact. Otherwise, there is no globalization, capitalism at the global level. So after the end of the Cold War, all these collapsed and adapted capitalism. How they adapted? They adapted it as a shock therapy. In Eastern European countries like Russia, they adapted it as a shock therapy because they were shocked by looking at the expansion or because of the prosperity of the Eastern European, Western European countries like Great Britain, France, Germany. They were really shocked by looking at the development policies of the Western European countries and the USA, and these Eastern European countries, which were erstwhile a form of USSR, they got shocked by looking at the capitalist development, and as a result, as a shock therapy, they started imposing the same level of development or capitalistic development in their states. And in the third world countries, it is capitalism expanded under the name of structural adjustment programs. If you look at India, India opened its market from, India became a capitalistic country from the socialist country through the means of IMF reforms in 1991, that is the liberalization, privatization and globalization, LPG reforms of 1991, which are also known as the structural adjustment programs. So the third world countries, under the name of structural adjustment programs, made capitalism to enter into their states, whereas the Eastern European countries, they had shifted from communism to capitalism as a shock therapy. With the establishment of WTO in 1995, the symbol of globalism has emerged, and globalism is a symbol of capitalism. WTO has proved it. It is a symbol of globalism, or it is a symbol of capitalism at global level. WTO is a symbol of capitalism becoming a global phenomena, right? This is how globalism emerged in the world. Otherwise, there is no such thing called capitalism at the global level. Earlier, the countries were divided into capitalist countries, communist countries, socialist countries. But after the end of the Cold War, some states went as a shock therapy towards capitalism, some states went as a structural adjustment programs like India, and they accepted capitalism in their countries. So this is a focus, right? So basically, Marxist scholars are focusing on the critical analysis of globalism. Why I said globalism as per capitalist is the operation of capitalism at the global level. And Marxism studies about capitalists because for them capitalism is the main reason for war. So in order to eliminate war and to bring peace, eternal peace, then automatically they have to end capitalism. Now they are studying how capitalism is bringing war. So their focus is on analysis of operation of capitalism at the global level, and the operation of capitalism at the global level is called globalization. So their primary focus is on globalization. Globalization means expansion of capitalism on global scale as per Marxists. That is what I said, right? The Marxist theories of international politics, hence they can be called as international political economy. So Marxist theory of international politics is also known as international political economy. why it is known as international political economy, because they are going to study the economic structures, how it is influencing the polity at the international level, right? So we call it as international political economy. Political economy is one approach we study in the first chapter of section A in paper 2, that is comparative politics. In comparative politics, there is one school known as political economic approach, where we study the impact of economy on the politics of the state. But at the international level, Marxists said that international political economy is known as Marxist theory of international politics. I think you are getting the point. Key theories. What are the schools or what are the key theories in international politics? Just like realism and liberalism, Marxism is also classified into two schools, that is the classical schools and the neo schools. Classical is known as orthodox, neo is known as this one. Classical is orthodox Marxism, neo Marxism. Classical Marxism is again classified into two, that is called theory of underdevelopment. There is one school called theory of underdevelopment, and then there is one important school which is very important for UPSC mains, that is the world systems theory. This is very, very important from the perspective of examination also. And then there is neo-Marxist school, that is the critical school, which we call it as a Frankfurt school, that we are going to see. So in Marxism, there are two subdivisions. One is the classical realism, classical Marxism, which is also known as the orthodox Marxism. Why they are called orthodox? Because they believe in the same phenomena what Karl Marx said. But the neo-Marxism brings the concept of Gramsci into their analysis. We will see how neo-Marxism differs from orthodox Marxism. But for now, remember that there are two sub-schools, orthodox Marxism and neo-Marxism. In orthodox Marxism, we have two schools, that is the theory of underdevelopment and world systems theory. As Marxists, we will analyze the causes and consequences of capitalism. What these schools are going to do? They are going to study or analyze what are the causes of capitalism, what are the consequences of capitalism. The consequence of capitalism ultimately is the war, right? They are going to study this. So far, I think you are getting the point. Now we will see this school first, the theories of underdevelopment. So orthodox Marxism, why this is called orthodox Marxism? They believe that historical materialism or economic interpretation of history. So they just thought that international politics are operating only through a monocausal theory, that is called historical materialism. So that is why this is called orthodox school, because they just focused on the economic structure. They didn't focus on the other structures which Gramsci has said. Gramsci said that apart from the economic culture, there is one more culture called the cultural impact, that they didn't study, that we study in neo-Marxism. So orthodox Marxists, they just focused on the historical materialism and the economic interpretation of history. So the first school in that is the theories of underdevelopment, or the theory of development of underdevelopment, or the dependency school. So the first school is the dependency school, or it is a theory which explains the development of underdevelopment. So these are the names that we have for dependency theory. The theories of underdevelopment, or the dependency theory, or the theories of development of underdevelopment, right? This is the first school that we are going to discuss. Who are the scholars? The prominent scholars are Mr. A.G. Frank and Samir Amin. Mr. A.G. Frank and Samir Amin are the two propounders of this school called dependency school. And it is based, what is the source? Lenin's Imperialism. Lenin's book of Imperialism, the highest stage of capitalism, is a source for these persons. And Lenin theory of imperialism, how Lenin said imperialism? Through a theory called dependency theory. What is dependency? Dependency is a word which we use for colonies. Colonies were dependent on the Western countries. So dependency is a word we use for colonies. Colonies were called as dependencies as per Lenin, right? This is called the dependency school, the theory of dependence under development of underdevelopment. A.G. Frank and Samir Amin were the prominent scholars, and this is based on Lenin's theory of imperialism. Right? According to Lenin, dependency theorem is also known as the theory of colonies, because dependencies are colonies. Right? Now, the theory of dependency school, or the theory of development of underdevelopment, that is the school which we are discussing. Dependency denotes a system of unequal exchange. If you are dependent on someone, then definitely this is going to be an unequal exchange, where the benefit goes to the core countries. I said what are core countries and what are peripheral countries, right? These are the two terms which we use to represent the states in Marxism. So dependency denotes an unequal exchange between the core and between the peripheral countries. There is an unequal exchange. What is this unequal exchange? Where core countries get prosper or benefits. Prosperity is to the core countries, whereas poverty is to the peripheral countries. So this is called unequal exchange. As a result of this unequal exchange, it leads to unequal development of peripheral countries and core countries. Core countries become overdeveloped, whereas the peripheral countries developed become underdevelopment of the periphery. Right? Now, A.G. Frank and Samir Amin says that though colonialism has ended formally, but in informal sense, it is continuing even today. What A.G. Frank and Amir Samin says that, okay, many people are saying that colonialism was ended way back in 1950s, but we see colonialism in the new form called neo-colonialism. In this neo-colonialism, these core countries are still exploiting the peripheral countries under the name of giving monetary benefit, like China is expanding Africa or USA is expanding other countries, exploiting other countries. How they are exploiting? By giving capital. They are exploiting the peripheral countries in the form of interest that they have to pay. Right? This is what the theory says. So they say that neo-colonialism is the reason of poverty in the global south. This is dependency theory. Now, if you look at what is the criticism of this school, criticism is only one, that is, they just focused on historical materialism. There are other factors apart from historical materialism, like cultural aspects or like technological aspects or like the political aspects, which are playing equal role in international politics. So the first criticism is they focused on historical materialism aspect. The second criticism is, however, this is the only criticism which is available. But however, if you want to understand what is the reasons for the development of underdevelopment of the global south, then this theory is really helpful. If you want to eliminate poverty from the third world countries, then you go through this theory, then it will provide us an insightful analysis into understanding the historical injustice that was done to the global southern countries. So this is what the first theory of international politics as far as Marxism says. So the first school that we have discussed is the dependency school, which is also known as the theory of development of underdevelopment. In this, we have discussed who are the major propounders. The major propounders are only A.G. Frank and Samir Amin, and who are the from what is their source? Their source is Lenin. So imperialism. Lenin said the dependency theorem. As per Lenin, dependencies are colonies. Colonies were dependent on the core countries, and there is an unequal exchange between the core and peripheral countries. As a result, this is leading to underdevelopment of the core, and it is leading to overdevelopment of the core, underdevelopment of the peripheral countries. As a result, the global north is becoming rich and prosper, whereas the peripheral countries are becoming poorer and poorer. As a result, they said that A.G. Frank and Samir Amin also says that though colonialism was ended formally, but it is still continuing under the name of neo-colonialism, where today it is not just physical presence of the masters in the colonies, but they are present in an indirect way in the form of multinational companies or in the form of the economic transactions that they are doing today. They are still exploiting. So this is neo-colonialism. The criticism of this school is that they are monocausal, or they just focused on the historical materialism, where they gave prime focus only to economy. But if you are to understand international politics, the critics of Marxism says that there are other schools, such as there are other things, such as apart from economy, we have polity, technological aspects, cultural aspects. So they are also playing certain important role. But however, this school is very, very important, because if you want to eliminate the so-called injustice or poverty in the global south, then this theory offers an insightful analysis for the elimination of this. So this is what the first theory says. In the next class, we will be dealing with the second school, that is the world systems approach. And we will be doing the remaining aspect, that is called the critical theory or the Frankfurt School. So far today, this is what the class is. So again, let me remind you what we have discussed. We have just discussed Marxism, what are as per Marx, or as per Marxist theory, Lenin is the first proponent of Marxism, and he has said the reason is capitalism is the cause for world wars, because capitalist has the tendency of exploitation, and there were a battle between the capitalists for the colonies because they want profits, and colonies acted as a best source for these profits due to their availability of cheap raw material, availability of cheap labor, as well as availability of big markets. So then they gave the theory called, they started analyzing the focus of Marxism in international politics is just the study of capitalism operating at the global level. The study of operation of capitalism at the global level is called as globalization. So they want to give a critical analysis of the globalization, that is the causes of globalization and consequences of globalization. Accordingly, they said that globalization was not a, capitalism was not a global phenomena until the end of the Cold War. Because until the end of the Cold War, the entire global world was classified into three blocks. One is the capitalist block, the socialist block, and the communist block. But it is after the end of the Second World War, after the end of the Cold War, that all the Eastern European countries as well as the Third World countries started accepting capitalism as their only remedy for their poverty. Some state accepted it as a shock therapy, some other states accepted it as a structural adjustment programs. However, they have accepted capitalism. As such, capitalism started operating at the global level. And then we have come to the schools, various sub-schools in Marxism. What are those various sub-schools? I said that is there are two schools, the realists and liberals, that is the classical Marxism and neo-Marxism. Classical Marxism is also known as the orthodox Marxism, whereas the neo-Marxism is called critical school or the Frankfurt school. In the orthodox school or the classical Marxist school, we have two sub-schools, that is the dependency theory, which is known as the development of underdevelopment, and there is second school called the Western world systems approach of Immanuel Wallerstein. In the next class, we are going to see the West, the second school of orthodox, that is Immanuel Wallerstein's world systems approach, and we will see the critical school. With that, we will be done with the Marxist school. I think this is what the discussion is, and it is very clear. Thank you for having the patience in listening to my lecture. And these are the lectures that we are making in memory of our grandfather who recently passed away. So this is a free lecture that we are offering to the PSIR students, and we are trying to cover in 40 days, we are trying to cover 80% of the syllabus in PSIR. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. Have a good day. We'll meet soon with the next schools immediately.